I got into real estate soon after graduating law school. I went to University of Pennsylvania. I got a degree from the Wharton School of Business. Then took some time off, went to law school and clerked for a judge, which I really enjoyed, in Camden, New Jersey, in the federal court. And then went to work at a law firm, which I didn't enjoy so much. I ended up staying about 5 months, realized that that was not the life I wanted, that I wasn't really cut out to be a real estate attorney. I got connected to real estate when I was in school with my brother and another friend. We were buying apartments. We bought a couple of apartments, fixed them up, and resold them, and sort of got interested in just the whole aspect of real estate because I didn't come from a background of real estate. When I left the law firm, I at the time got connected through a law school classmate of mine with my current partner, Sandy Lowenthal. He had come out of a family construction business. I had a finance and legal background, and the two of us decided to give it a shot and try to do some development together, some projects together, and see how that worked. We really didn't know each other. We met on a park bench in Washington Square Park in 1984, and we immediately, or very quickly thereafter, connected with a gentleman who was the father of one of my sister's college roommates, who was in a distressed situation. He owned some four small buildings on Avenue A in the East Village. At the time, it was an emerging section of the city. He had some issues with a number of the tenants. They were represented by a tenant lawyer, and there was a lot of distress, physical distress around the property. We came in, partnered with him, worked with the attorney and with the tenants. They all relocated, we helped them relocate, paid for them to relocate, and then renovated the property, and 2 years later were able to sell condominiums. I think there were like 15 condominiums, and we still own the retail space that we built at that time, which was almost 35 years ago. That was a successful project. The market was headed in the upswing. We then went in and bought a property from a relative of Harry Chapin, the former folk singer, who had died tragically a few months earlier. The city had turned over two buildings on Avenue B in the same neighborhood, and those buildings came with a deed restriction because the city, they were city owned, and the city turned it over to his estate and his brother, and said, if you develop these buildings, you have to do 25% affordable housing. When we took over those buildings, he was having trouble getting financing and figuring out how to develop them. We bought them from him. We then went, hired an attorney, went to HPD at the time. This was under the Koch administration, and Mayor Koch was just starting his 10-year affordable housing plan. And we sort of got guidance. It was outside any program they had, but we renovated these two buildings. Again, this was done as home ownership. We sold the co-ops, 75% of them were market rate, and 25% were sold as affordable co-ops. We were able to do that without subsidy because we got the property for a very, small amount of money because the city had given it to the Chapin family for nothing. We finished that in 1987. That was right around the time when the stock market was crashing, the real estate in New York City, the real estate economy was starting to reverse itself and head into a little bit of an abyss. It was also right around the same time I mentioned Mayor Koch was in the middle of his 10-year housing plan, and President Reagan at the time passed a tax code in 1986 that totally transformed the way in which affordable housing was built. It went from heavily subsidized projects with, 4-for-1, 8-for-1 tax write-offs that were run traditionally through the federal government, through HUD, and syndicated out through groups of individual investors. And instead, we have what the current underlying basis of the affordable housing industry is now, which is the low-income tax credit was passed. It was a Republican program. It allowed tax credits to be attached to any affordable housing project where the area median income was less than 60%. At the time in New York, that equated to, you know, $25,000 incomes. So it was really for the working poor or the working lower middle class. And we were able to figure out, we were early in the game in that. I had a tax background and I had a good finance background, and we were able to figure out how to use the tax credit program in conjunction with the Koch housing plan, which allowed us, even with limited experience, to win a couple of RFPs. Those RFPs were at the time in the Bronx, in the South Bronx, and that sort of catapulted us into the affordable housing arena. It also didn't hurt that the market in New York City from 1988 to probably around 1993-94 was pretty dead. It was pretty tough to get financing. There wasn't a lot of market rate activity going on. So one of the few places where banks were lending, investors were investing through the tax credit, was in affordable housing. So we got in somewhat fortuitously, but it became a staple of the business. And at the time, it was my partner, myself. Maybe we had one or two folks helping us. But I was doing almost everything. My partner was running the construction side of the business, and I was running the financing, but I was also working with city government, learning my way around the programs, and in fact, doing the lease up, interviewing all the tenants who moved into our buildings. And I found it not only intellectually challenging, which I enjoyed, but it was also refreshing and rewarding from just a standpoint of being able to do something that was really meaningful for people who were getting housing that they otherwise wouldn't have been able to afford. And contrary to what the impression of affordable housing was at the time, it was families. We were housing families. We were getting, people were bringing report cards for their children, and people were bringing their, you know, taking pride. They, for the most part, people were working people who just couldn't get quality housing in a city that was starting to escalate. The rents were starting to escalate, costs were escalating. So we were able to give an opportunity to people in these communities to get really quality, newly constructed or newly renovated housing. And I found that the intellectual challenge was appealing, but even more appealing was the ability to do something in the communities we were in that was incredibly meaningful for those families. And to top it off, as a business, we were able to make money doing it and build a successful business without having the backing of a lot of capital resources, because we were young and we didn't have a lot of capital. Affordable housing enabled us to start. There was less need for that kind of investment capital, and it was an area that there was less market risk, especially at a time where the market was going in the wrong direction, and that was appealing as well. I'm a somewhat of a risk taker, and I'm in a business where there's a lot of risk involved, and I was 27 years old starting my own business, so I guess I was taking that risk as well. But when it comes to investing in real estate and in the kind of activities that we engage in, we try to minimize our risk and try to think about the downside of everything we get involved in. Affordable housing is an area where you can, as I've often put it, you hit singles and doubles, but you don't often hit home runs or strike out. And that's sort of a nice place to be in the real estate business.